Hello and welcome to a video dedicated to Lemony Snicket's Who Could That Be at This Hour, the first installment of the All the Wrong Questions series, a novel from the first-person perspective of Lemony Snicket as he arrives to the unfamiliar town of Stained-by-the-Sea to solve a mystery with a chaperone from VFD, or Volunteer Fire Department. This acts as a prequel to a series of unfortunate events following the Baudelaire orphans. And I'd like to preface that this video will not go into all the literary allusions that Handler features. There are so many literary allusions referenced by Snicket and the Bellerophon brothers that an entire video could be solely dedicated to them. You can find a compendium of all the literary allusions on the Snicket Wiki or on Wikipedia. They did a great job already at finding all the references and Easter eggs. I will also be talking about the author using his real name, Daniel Handler, rather than his pen name, Lemony Snicket, as I already have done. Now let's start with the first observation. Prosper Loss, the owner of the Lost Arms, has such an unfortunate name. Of course, he would rather be called Prosper, as he makes sure to tell Snicket at the beginning of the book, rather than Mr. Lost. His name is a bipolar opposition. Lost and Prosper are mutually exclusive opposites, which find themselves to form his name. Furthermore, his hotel is named the Lost Arms Hotel. The statue we see in the illustration has no arms. They have been lost. This references how Prosper lost his wife, Alice Lost, after she perished in a fire in this hotel many years ago. His wife was a sculptor who would keep her statues in the West Wing. Prosper has lost his wife, or more symbolically, lost the love in his life. He no longer has loving arms to hold him, and so it is a fitting name for the hotel. A final interpretation could be that Prosper, metaphorically, doesn't have any arms throughout the novel. He is always the passive observer. He just sits behind his desk or occasionally eavesdrops on others. He lets things happen before him all the time, unable to reach out and have any impact on the external occurrences happening around him. His arms are, in a sense, gone, useless, unable to grasp outwards. Shortly following this, Snicket and S. Theodora Markson, his chaperone, are placed in the Far East Suite. The far and far east highlights the narrative distance Snicket has with the town and how he comes from the city, which is quite far away. Snicket, and even more so Markson, are removed from the happenings of the town. They don't understand what is going on, and their choice of room emphasizes their distance, though physically. A few pages later, we finally visit the library, where Dashiell Qwerty, the sub-librarian, greets Snicket. Qwerty is the type pattern of most English keyboards. Commonly, there are Qwerty and Azurdi keyboards, depending on the layout of the keys. Giving someone in the library the name Qwerty provides a juxtaposition to the literary world of books. Comparing books to computers perhaps highlights the societal shift from reading to watching on a screen. Now, even libraries have become tech hubs with public computers for people to use. Furthermore, did you notice that the library is right next to the police station? They share the same building. When I read this, I immediately thought of this as symbolic implications. The library represents knowledge, so maybe knowledge is a prisoner. The library is being held captive by the police. Knowledge is difficult to attain in Stained-by-the-Sea. The truth is hidden from the world, held captive by the authorities. That is certainly true with the mysterious bell that makes people don masks, the character of Hangfire, or the secrets of the Bombinating Beast. No one knows what is really going on. Speaking of the Bombinating Beast, Pip and Squeak Bellerophon, or more formally known as Pechuchet and Bouvard Bellerophon, pick up Snicket in their taxicab. Their last name, Bellerophon, is a reference to the Greek hero under the same name. According to GreekGods.org, the hero is most famous for just defeating a chimera, which is a fire-breathing mythical monster, and riding a Pegasus around in the sky. The parallels here are uncanny. The Chimera represents the Bombinating Beast, albeit the Bellerophon brothers do not kill it, and the Pegasus parallels a taxicab, their mode of transportation. Now their first names. Pechuchet and Bouvard references the satirical novel by the same name written by Gustave Flaubert. The book itself was left unfinished, and perhaps that alludes to the fact that Pip and Squeak are, in a sense, incomplete as well. They are two children who haven't yet matured into adults, but have the burden of continuing their sick father's taxi legacy. Their upbringing was halted early, rendering their childhood incomplete, much like Flaubert's novel. Moving forward, we get to the scene where Snicket is with Moxie before he steals the statue of the Bombinating Beast. They have some pretty in-depth discussions, and we learn more about Moxie's central motive. "I'm staying in practice as a journalist," he says. "Then, when I leave this town, I'll be ready to join the newspaper." You would have noticed this when reading, but I just think it's interesting how our central values shine through here in this moment. Snicket and Moxie eat Oreoshits al pesto, sorry if I mispronounced that, which Snicket says is Italian for little ears. This sets up our theme of adultism. Almost all the adults in the novel look down on the children and undermine them. Handler uses this to his advantage by interweaving character and adultism, especially with Markson, when she almost always immediately discredits everything Snicket says. Moxie further refines this theme with her quote, "Adults never tell children anything." The orecchiette al pesto represents the little ears the adults have in this series. They're almost always unwilling to hear the thoughts of the children. By doing so, they are oblivious to the sinister events at play. Ignorance, in this case, is bliss for the adults. Their little ears help them stay grounded. Adultism becomes much more apparent in the subsequent books in the series, and even more so in A Series of Unfortunate Events, if you've read that. Finally, as part of this scene, Snicket references Markson, his chaperone, in this line, "After all, the most interesting things are usually in the bottom drawer." Markson is ranked last among the chaperones, and so she is at the bottom drawer. So with this idea, we find out why Snicket chose her in the first place. In the next scene, Snicket, after his journey on the hawser, lands in Handkerchief Heights and visits Ellington Faint's cabin in the woods. This is our first encounter with Ellington, so we must make sure to pay super close attention. Keep in mind that Faint is her last name. This is a telling detail to her character and a clever last name. First, you will notice that Handler writes this first encounter with especially dark, domineering diction. They meet in shadow. Ellington is standing over Snicket's body, domineering over it and casting her shadow upon him like a powerful force. In fact, Handler writes that Ellington had already begun to cast an enormous shadow across his life and time. When she brings Snicket into her cabin, Handler emphasizes Ellington's black hair that is blacker than night, green eyes, and black nails, all colors of villainy and sickness. Her eyebrows coil like question marks, illustrating an uncanny parallel to the abominating beast who used its body to coil into the S in Stained by the Sea's newspaper. Her smile is described as shadowy in the moonlight, conveying a tone of untrustworthiness. Furthermore, Ellington lives in a white cottage, which provides a stark juxtaposition to the night and all the darkness surrounding Ellington's description. It's almost like she doesn't belong there, which turns out to be the truth. It's not her cabin. Finally, she drinks coffee, a staple of adult beverages, and when she offers Snicket some coffee, he has an almost repulsive reaction. "Coffee," he says, his voice louder and higher than he had planned. "I don't drink coffee." This cements the disconnect Snicket and Ellington have, though their paths cross more than they should. So why am I highlighting all these details? Well, Handler paints Ellington with predominantly evil imagery, her black hair and nails, her green slithery eyes, her shady smile. Her eyebrows mimic the abominating beast, which is a pretty sinister looking statue. And finally, to cement this all in place, Snicket has a repulsive reaction to the liquid that Ellington consumes every single day, coffee. If Snicket represents the archetypal good character of the novel, then Ellington should be his opposite, given that Snicket has such a strong disliking for her favorite drink. The darkest, blackest drink in the world, coming none other than from Black Cat Coffee. The black cat, obviously a symbol of bad luck. In short, Ellington is the foil of sorts to Snicket, and she should not be trusted. This will certainly come up later in her search for her father, and especially in the fourth book, where her father is revealed. Later in the book, we cross paths with Ellington again. Handler emphasizes her dark, dark hair and her question mark eyebrows. From her description, I would never trust her with something as important as the abominating beast. But Snicket develops a strong liking for the Faint we will follow throughout the series. A few pages later, she gives Snicket an orange. Why an orange? Well, I'd wager that it's a deeply Edenic symbol. Ellington is giving Snicket the forbidden fruit, the fruit of the fall, original sin. Again, we see the deeper, darker side to Ellington that Snicket does not see, though in a symbolic way. She is Eden giving the fruit to share with Adam. Moreover, an orange can also represent fire and flames. Fire, we'll find, is a prevailing force of evil in the series. Many places burn down because of Hangfire and his goons. So, Snicket is basically escalating the central conflict by eating the orange. He eats the forbidden fruit and begins his caper involving Hangfire and the fires. A masterful way to end the first book, in my opinion. I'd like to end on one last observation. When Ellington and Snicket visit the library to find the abominating beast tucked behind an analysis of black, brown, and beige, Ellington remarks that it is the first book that she would have checked out. This cements the argument that Snicket and Ellington are foil characters. Snicket would have checked the book out last, thinking that it was the most boring book in the world, but Ellington would have checked it out first. Fun fact, Black, Brown, and Beige is an album by Duke Ellington, who inspired the name of Ellington fame. Given that, it's not a surprise that Ellington would have read that book first. And there you have it, those are all my observations for the first book. Thanks for watching the video. I find it fun to decipher Handler's hidden messages inscribed in something which may seem like a children's book on the outside, but can be looked into so much deeper.